إن الباطل كان زهوقا. صدق الله العظيم. Respected elders and brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of each and every atom in this universe, to the extent that even good and evil, vice and virtue, truth and falsehood have been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something unanimously accepted by all the scholars and ulama throughout history. Now, what are the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created good and evil? It is not in reality the subject of my talk. But there are valid reasons for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creating both. I will just give you one saying, which is one small reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created both. The saying goes, I have learned silence from the talkative. I have learned the beauty of silence when I saw people who are excessively talkative, and when they go to the extent of talking rubbish, then I have learned silence from seeing people like that. I have learned tolerance from the intolerant. I have learned kindness from the unkind, to what extent they will go to be cruel. I have learned the importance of being upon truth by the behavior of those who follow falsehood. Yet I am ungrateful to these teachers. It just gives you one example where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created good and evil. أَشَّيْءُ تَعْرِفُ بِأَزْدَادِهَا. There is an Arabic saying, a thing is recognized by its opposite. You realize the value of light by seeing darkness. Nevertheless, this is not why we are making mention. Suffice to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created both good and evil, vice and virtue, truth and falsehood. And throughout history, there has always been a clash and a confrontation between these two forces. Truth has come in all its humility. Truth has come in the strength of its faith, not in the strength of material power. And it has always confronted falsehood, which has come with its arrogance, with its show of strength as far as material power is concerned, with its stubbornness. It has come with all those things. And we always find that truth has always dominated and has always defeated falsehood, sooner or later. Sometimes sooner, sometimes later. But we find that always truth has always defeated batil. وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقِّ وَزَحَقَ الْبَاطِلِ. And say unto the people that haqq and truth has come and falsehood has vanished, because falsehood in reality is a vanishing act. Therefore, when we look at history, we find batil and falsehood emerge in the form of Fir'aun. Then truth came in the personality of that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. In the 6th century, when falsehood threatened to engulf the entire world, then it was challenged, and not only challenged, but overturned by our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Then furthermore in history, then when batil came in the form of Hajjaj bin Yusuf, then truth came in the form of Abdullah ibn Zubair and Sayyid ibn Jubair rahmatullah alayhi. When batil and falsehood came in the form of the Khalifa Mu'tasim Billah, then truth came in the form of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. When batil and falsehood came in the form of the Khalifa Mansur, then truth came in the form of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi. When batil and falsehood came in the form of Nizamul Muluk, Badshah, the king, then truth came in the form of Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi. Then furthermore, you will find that when batil and falsehood came in the form of Jalaluddin Akbar, the Mughal emperor, who wanted to amalgamate all the religions and make one religion and call it Deen-e-Akbar, then he was confronted and he was defeated by Shah Waliullah, by Sheikh Mujaddid Al-Faisali rahmatullah alayhi. When batil came in the form of the fitna of anmudaj, then truth came in the form of shawaliullah rahmatullah alayh. When the hordes of Tatar, they threatened to invade all Muslim lands, they were confronted by a noble personality, by Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh. In short, whenever falsehood has come, there has always been a group of people, sometimes in the form of a personality, sometimes in the form of a group, that has always confronted the batil and the falsehood. لِكُلِّ فِرْعَوْنٍ مُوسَى. For each and every Fir'aun that has come in this world, there has always been a Musa who has confronted it. This is something that we find throughout history. And today when we look at it, we each and every one of us, every one of us would like to be on truth. Who is there who would desire to be on falsehood? No one would like it unilaterally, no one would like it readily. Each and everyone would say, I want to be on the truth. However, there are certain salient features with regard to the truth. Some of it I would like to make mention today, some of it we will make mention of it inshallah in the coming weeks. The first thing that we must realize, we are living in an age, and we are living in a society and an environment where there is a certain moral, or should we call it immoral philosophy, that seems to be dominant in the so-called liberal secular world. It is known and it is termed as moral relativism. Do not be fooled by the very fancy words, is what they call it. But what it means is that good and bad and vice and virtue are not eternal. They are relative concepts. They depend upon the people who are carrying it out. Thus, if two people stay out of wedlock, male and female, and they themselves are happy with it, then it is true and it is right for them. Or if two people want to adopt a path of being, you know, homosexuals, then it is up to them, it is correct for them to do so. You see, they say that there is no moral principles which are valid or unanimously obliging or accepted by humanity. Therefore, good and bad, or vice and virtue, truth and falsehood are like beauty. They are only in the eyes of the beholder. They are only in the eyes of the beholder. There was one Christian cleric who was quoted in the Times magazine with regard to the whole Bill Clinton saga when he said, there is no virtue and there is no sin. There are only things that people do. There is no vice, there is no virtue. There are only things that people do. Then you find this moral, you know, relative concept with regard to morality from the United Nations, who would not say anything with regard to women and children being killed in Kashmir and Palestine, but would make a huge UN cry, and this go for all the human rights organizations, when the name, or if someone were to make mention that homosexualism or lesbianism is something which is immoral and it is something which is wrong. They would not say anything with regard to the women and children killed by in Kashmir and Palestine, but they would make a big UN cry. This is what you call concepts, moral, what they call relative concepts. In fact, you will find in today's world that you have in universities particular new science of knowledge that has emerged. And what they call it? They call it situation ethics. There are masters of, and there are professors in a science which they call situation ethics. What is situation ethics? That good and bad depend on the situation that you are in. It is in the eyes of the beholder. In fact, I heard a university professor once, a Muslim, who made mention that he went to study sociology. The first thing they teach in there is what they call value clarification. Clarify your values. There is nothing like a value that is unanimously accepted as being good. The first thing they do is value clarification. So beauty, they say, is in the eyes of the beholder. And right and wrong is like in the eyes of the beholder. You see, we know that in our, you know, in Urdu poetry, there is a very famous folklore of Layla Majnu. Layla Majnu was very passionate in his love for Layla. So someone one day saw and managed to see, you know, Layla going past and was not impressed by the beauty of this Layla whom Majnu was talking so passionately about. So he went to complain. He said, you talk so much poetry of yours with regard to how good Layla is. What is this that you're making? Nothing so impressive. So he replied, don't look at her with your eyes, look at her with my eyes. So this is what they say, good and bad is on the with regard to the eyes of the beholder. And they will bring about complexities to strengthen the argument. One of the arguments go like this. They will say, would you tell the location of your friend to a would-be murderer? Would you tell the location of your friend to a would-be murderer? If you won't tell him, you have spoken a lie. And if you tell him, then you have become an accomplice to murder. Like these type of complex arguments, they triumphantly declare that many a times right can be wrong and vice versa. You hear the argument with regard to a justifying adultery. They will say in many cases, unmarried love is better than marital misery. So therefore go and commit adultery. These are the type of situations that are emerging and are finding a place in the heart and the minds of our Muslim people. We find it many a times. When we see this whole mess, then we are grateful to the Sharia that Islam is. How many people follow falsehood? Falsehood will be falsehood. And haq will be haq. We are thankful to our religion, our rich sharia, that has given us stability in our moral order, which has given us such a beautiful moral landscape. And then furthermore, with regard to that, it has given us the example of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have a beautiful example in Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to guide you in the so-called complexities of life. Islam does not make the mistake of offering few Boy Scout principles. Many people today would reduce Islam to that. Few Boy Scout principles. It is a whole concept of life. It is not few Boy Scout principles that would find a place in a showcase rather than in real life. So this is one aspect with regard to haq and truth and between truth and falsehood. It is not something that is dependent upon people, how they see. There is a clear-cut morality, there is a clear-cut truth which has been explained to us by our beloved Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And if we want to follow it, then we are obliged. If we want to follow truth, to follow that moral guideline which has come from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. The second thing that I would like to make mention of today is, with regard to truth and falsehood, is very true that truth will eventually triumph. But before that happens, you will find that falsehood has a very great time in making fun and in ridiculing the truth and people who are on truth. It has a very good time in ridiculing people who are on truth and ridiculing the truth. Therefore, truth, and if you want to be on haq, it attracts people of determination and courage. It attracts people who do not worry about the insults and ridicule that they will definitely get in the pursuit of truth. It does not worry about them. It does not deter them in following the truth because they are focused on the objective of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has made mention when he describes people who are loved by Allah and Allah loves them. One of the qualities is, وَلَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ. They do not fear the blame and the criticism of people who criticize them or blame them. They don't worry about that. Remember, today we are faced with a situation where people do things not because it's right and wrong, but how acceptable it is to the public. Very, very powerful force. It's a very powerful force. It appeals to every person's like not to be insulted or ridiculed. It appeals to that particular thing. No one likes to be insulted. No one likes to be ridiculed. So it appeals to that particular thing of yours, not to be insulted or ridiculed. And this is what social pressure appeals and forces you to do. And in a good environment, the social pressure could force you to do things which are good. You see, if you have a social pressure and you have a good environment, then it becomes a stigma for anyone to do something which is wrong. And this is something that we in our communities need to develop. People who are evil, they must be shown no respect, no matter how much wealth they have. That is something that we need to develop. That the social pressure, which is very important, must be developed for the sake of truth. That people who do gabgal and do, they are unfortunate to use this word, they do unda danda and they use other means of adopting their wealth, they must be dishonored in society. They must be not looked upon in society. But that is an ideal society which we don't have. In the society that we have today in the real world, it is opposite. People are forced by social pressure to do things that are wrong, not do the things that are right. Even parents who today worry about peer pressure, the pressure that friends have over their children, they will also bow down to this pressure for the sake of conformity. You will see it. They will take part in the so-called office Christmas parties. You know, they will take part with all this accompanying evil, mixing, and there will be liquor and everything, a whole scene, an environment of, you know, being free. They will take part in it, and then to justify it, and they will do it because of social pressure. They don't want to be called backward, or don't want to be called fundamentalist or fanatic. And after doing it, they will say, Islam allows us to do what society wants us to do. Unfortunately, the mullah is very ignorant, and he is not as progressive as what we are and the way Islam is. They would justify things like that. So even the parents who worry about peer pressure for their friends, they will themselves buckle down to pressure, social pressure. But we don't realize that whenever we look at history, we find that the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam had always been ridiculed. They had always been the object of scorn from the very same people whom the Prophet wanted to save from eternal doom. They were made the object of scorn from whom? The very same people whom Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Anbiya wanted to save. They were called liars and sorcerers. They were called crazy people. Allah had to say, Ma anta bin imati rabbika bi majnoon. O Prophet Almighty, Allah, you are not crazy the way people are saying you are crazy. They were called, you are too pious. You are too pious. You are not, you are backward before, therefore. They were saying, Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salatu wasalam, incident, looking at 12 Supara. What they say, oh Shuaib, your piety tells us to do this? They were ridiculed in such a manner. Our ulama writes, and history confirms it, it is not a realistic goal for any believer. It is not a realistic goal for any believer that he leads his life without being the object of scorn or ridicule sometime in his life. Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi has one beautiful Arabic poem. Qila innal ilaha du waladin. People have said that Allah Ta'ala has children. Qila innal rasoola qad kahana. People have said that Aliyadu billah Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a sorcerer and he has made jadu. Ma najallahu wa rasoolu ma'an. When people have not left Allah in his Rasul, then where do you expect to be left behind? So the most, you know, one of the most ridiculous things to do would be to leave the straight path, to leave the straight path for the fear of being ridiculed at. The most stupid thing to do. And if you want an example, you are, I will conclude with this. Look at the incident of the Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. The Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam was told by Allah Ta'ala to build a ship and to build an ark. And wayasna'il fulk, and he started building it. Kullama marra alayhi mala'um min qawmin. Then the people who used to be against him and they used to pass him making the ship, sakhiru min, they used to mock at him. Look at this crazy person. He is building a ship thousands of miles away from the sea. قَالَ إِن تَسْخَرُوا مِنَّا. Then Allah Ta'ala told us, Nuh alayhi salam, tell them, إِن تَسْخَرُوا مِنَّا, if you are mocking at us, فَإِنَّا نَسْخَرُوا مِنْكُمْ, we will also mock at you one day. كَمَا تَسْخَرُونَ, the way you are mocking at us. And Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam's laugh and mocking at them was the last laugh. Because the flood waters then wiped away the people who were on batil. It wiped away their self-assurance, their so-called righteousness. We need to take a lesson from there. That yes, people who are on truth will be sometimes ridiculed. But that doesn't mean you must stay away from it. It has always been the forte of people who are on truth. You will get this, but remain determined and steadfast upon the truth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you a tawfiq of understanding.